just the plays, the game, the way that the games are played. We're going at what, 20 minutes each game. We're seeing at the draft at the tail end of each pick. We're always thinking who is getting the lead, who is ahead. And the answer is no one at this point. Both of them have their own win conditions. And what I like about game number three is that both teams have good scaling. Farsa Beatrix for the side of Blacklist International. It's going to be the Clint Sicilian for the side of Onyx Esports. My God, what a game three.
Yeah, this game three is going to be good. It's a 50-50 between the compositions, but it's going to be whether they live or they get sent back home. It's Onyx Esports up against Blacklist International. I have to take a deep breath for that one. I am so nervous for both of these teams. This has got to be so much pressure and so much stress.
Well, let's go then. Fans everywhere, chat right now. Hashtag go Onyx or hashtag break the code. We want to see who has the most feisty fans right now as we are already into this game.
Gonna be a real skills matchup into the side lanes. Lapu Lapu versus the Hylos. It's kind of easier for the Hylos for sure, but in a way that Edward can make the plays for as well. Top lane is the more even one in a way.
I think it's the most, yeah, I would agree with you. It's definitely the more even one. Nobody's really going to get anywhere unless they want to get really, really ballsy with the mechanics so far. But you can tell that Blacklist International already moving up there to change the odds in towards Beatrix's favor.
Oh, very nice pokes coming out from Oh My Venus already with the Soul Bloom. Just extra damage that you get is also, that also means extra strength in that side lane. And already they have denied one or two minions away from CW. Kind of means that Ohe will get to level 3 faster than Onyx Esports would love.
Very much so. And now again, you can see the Keyboy already rotating to the top side. Blacklist trying to make something happen here. Also going for the vertical jungling. Both of the jungles trading spots. Yeah. But it is going to be Blacklist just picking up the pace in that top side. We'll just back away once again as they both want to go for the neutral objective at this point.
Yeah. You can see that Onyx Esports are kind of trading band. It becomes way clear as Suns.
Ooh, it's tough. It's really, really tough here to go for, but he does get the cancel on that feather airstrike. Could they punish onto Oh My Venus here? Thornrows is already coming up as Haji, as well as Oh My Venus slowly back away. Wise, now it's in trouble. He's lost position. Daytona's Walker is going to come down. He's trying to salvage the situation as long as possible. Edward in the back already coming as the Bravest Warrior comes in with the Rage Blade. Finds the kill onto Awards Keyboy immediately and will be going down to the Phantom Execution. He survives a little bit longer. Kill going over to Boo. Boots. Oh, is there any more? Nope. Looks like they finally go for the reset. But CW, he's looking for the opportunity to get on top of Haji.
Double lane treatment for CW for a bit. But they still want to give it to Drian. The call out was, okay, go back to your lane. I need this farm. Drian, as the Sicilian, needs all of the stacks, needs to farm up. And it kind of means that Onyx Esports might have a little bit of an edge when it comes to late game scaling. However, I did like the move coming out from Onyx Esports. They forced two flickers on both Haji as well as Oh My Venus in the mid lane, and then eventually punished Wise in that turtle fight. However, Edward was phenomenal with the Lapu Lapu, salvaging that fight. Eventually, now it's Blacklist International in the lead.
Every time I see the Farsa low and a Clint, I would just think, oh my god, it's a Sin moment. It's a Sin moment when he just flickers forward and goes for the kill. But yeah, again, for the side of Onyx Esports, what they need to do is very similar from the first game. Just play it safe, but maybe Blacklist is not going to give that opening to Onyx right now. Look at the pressure.
Yeah, they're controlling this river line for so long. It's kind of tough to actually, you know, get the pressure that they're looking for on these side lanes. But let's pull up the item list so far. As we see, Wise trying to zone out CW from this side to continue. Continue to put pressure on towards his top, but now here comes Sans as well as Keyboy. The rest of the team is coming on through. It's going to be Oh My Venus pulling him out of that situation as Oheb uses Nibiru's Passion to clear the wave as quickly as possible. Even the Gold Crab getting taken away by Wise.
I'm just surprised in how pixel perfect each player plays this. I mean, even Wise, he activated the so-called teamwork to kind of assume where CW will be, and CW did not roll into that area. And by that, they were able to dodge that skill coming out from the Barats. And then eventually, they also dodged the Nibiru's Passion.
Oh, here comes Sans. He wants to get on top of OYB as the perfect execution does. It comes out, but it really does not matter. Drian to try to deter everybody else. The dive has failed, and now they back away. At least no harm, no foul.
Yeah, the thing is, it's really good for a setup onto the turtle, right? You get someone to recall, and that is Venus, the guy. Oh my god! Okay. It's going to be the cage catching two members. But again, again, it's all just for the setup, and right now on Esports, they just don't have the resources to be able to contest this turtle. They are going to give it away.
Yep.
The big advantage of having a jungling Barrett is that you get easy access to the objectives, particularly the turtle. It's just very difficult to contest the Barrett just taking the objectives, right? And Onyx Esports did not even try at all. The only way for them to be able to secure a turtle or a neutral objective is that if they poke Blacklist International so low that they have to back down.
I mean, let's not forget that, you know, the perfect execution as well as Sicilian's ult already being expanded in that initial top dive. And I think that was also one of a couple of reasons. Like, yes, it is difficult, but also, you know what? We're not going to risk it. We really don't have good odds. Might as well give it away. We'll find an opening elsewhere.
Yeah. Being one of the...
What was that damage? Excuse me.
Yeah.
That was literally just from Wise and the twin blades of Edward. Oh my god. Half HP taken away. And this is the thing. Edward and Wise. Wise is two levels ahead of Sans. And in the top side, Blacklist already pushing the base.
Yep, they want to punish Boots here so far on this Hylos. He pops down the glorious pathway. And it looks like, I mean, they get him low, but really doesn't matter. It is Hylos. Sans is there to cover him for now. But let's not forget that currently Wise a full level ahead. And pressure being absorbed here. Edward going to be taking bot tier 1.
Yeah. One of the specials of Edward is that he is great at this split pushing. They find openings with this Lapu-Lapu. Also takes advantage of the mobility that the Lapu-Lapu has. And then, of course, layer their stun with this Edward play. So, unlike the previous games, Blacklist International are now utilizing all of their members in the early stage, 6 minutes in.
I think they're also utilizing their wave clear, right? To get priority?
Yeah, they are utilizing their wave clear, but again, what they need to understand right now is that they do not have the lane pressure anywhere right now, right? The thing is, that mid control is just all on the hands of Blacklist International. The downside of picking the Sicilian, yes, you can scale to the late game, but in that early stage, up to the mid game, You can kind of say you're useless, right? You can't roam as fast as the Farsa. You can't help around anywhere on the map except for that mid lane. And even in the mid lane, you're not going to be able to do a whole lot of damage. The only thing you really provide is that cage, right? Getting the CC done, but even that is hard to land.
It is very hard to land, and it's always like, okay, it's very strong when it comes like the damage output as well as the lockdown, but can you land it? That's the problem.
Yep, we're seeing Hylos already be dropping down the glorious pathway here just to ensure, draw a line in the sand, say, hey, Blacklist International, we don't want you taking our mid-tier one. We saw what happened with that. We saw what happened the last time. Better not. We're not going to make the same mistake.
In game number two, we saw Blacklist International get to four turtles, and it seems like it is indeed the trajectory that Blacklist International wants to go for. 91 seconds from this time means that they will get another turtle.
Well, here we go. Everett engaging onto CW. Rageblade being used as well. CW cannot get out of this. This is going to be a kill pick from Blacklist International. A little sad. And even CW, he knew that it wasn't worth flickering.
Yeah, again, it was just him caught out, right? If you use a flicker, it's going to be wasted completely. Edward has already popped that ultimate. Wise has put all his resources down there. So what Onyx needs to do, again, is just look for the trades constantly. Yep. Just wait for this Sicilian to become a threat.
Oh, good vision.
Up here comes the Siege once again. Wise, and as well as Haji, doing a phenomenal job. Boots is holding the lane back, making sure that this Tier 1 stands tall, and he will sacrifice as much HP as possible to do so. Good shots, but you can see that Ohem, he's just slowly chipping away at it.
This is illegal, man. Look, it's gonna be him taking it without the minions. The mid lane turret will fall.
Should not be allowed at all.
Oh my god. Blacklist International, once again, 5,000 gold lead in the 8th minute of the game. Onyx Esports Boots, he's able to zone away the members, but for how long? It seems like it is inevitable this time around, because again, Blacklist, very unlike the second game, they have a scaling comp as well. They have these late game, they have the pressure, and they have a very tanky frontline.
Yep, it's stressful. It's stressful so far, but Onyx, they're playing hyper defensively here, and it's they haven't made too many crazy plays at all. And more importantly, Keyboy is making sure when he opens up the map, he's playing it. He's also stutter stepping. He's walking in, slowly pulling back just in case he gets a reaction if somebody's in the brush.
Don't want to be in this position if you're the Lancer. You want to always go for the kill. So far, Sans is 0-0-1 because they only have one kill total. It's because they can't get control of the map.
Oh, here we go. Another engagement comes down as they manage to back away here. Good hit as they pull back Keyboy. Ohem does not miss.
Oheb on this Beatrix. Three games in a row. This guy is on a roll. Even when in the game that they lost, they were so dominant. He was so dominant in the lane on this Beatrix. And right now, again, it is going to be a free lord for the side of Blacklist International.
9 minutes. It's the ultimate bonding experience we're talking about. And it's easy for Blacklist International to just take over the map. The vision that Blacklist International are able to get is just way too superior compared to Onyx Esports, as Onyx Esports cannot go deep.
And this time around, their high ground is only on CW and the side. Oh my God, side of Sicilian, right? So these two members only. And Dreon, he hasn't scaled up to the point where he's a huge threat right now. It might be over before even it starts for Onyx.
That's definitely a big scary factor for all of Onyx Esports fans now. They do have great late game, but will we approach late game? That's the question. Is Blacklist, they're snowballing through.
They're snowballing a lot, and this is the biggest lead we've seen thus far coming in between both of the teams.
4K.
Yep, it's 9K now, and it's about to be, it might even be an inhibitor if they do this right. Here comes a Feather Airstrike once again. Edward already going to be sacrificing his life for the greater good. His boots already absorbing as much as he can. He still makes it out, flickers over the wall for safety. The next wave is coming through. Perfect execution coming out for the side of Sands here. Will they survive? Can they hold it? Yes, they hold the inhibitor strong, but Oheb says, nah, false hope. I'm breaking it regardless.
Oh my goodness. This Renner plays from Oheb. You know, I think that Oheb and all of the Beatrix fans out there, they might be blaming Oheb for a nerf in the next patch. This performance, it kind of asks for a nerf, right?
It kind of does, but once again, they're doing it just like in Game 1 as Onyx performed against Blacklist. Now Boots going in for an engagement on top of Oh My Venus. Daytona's Welcome is going to punish him here. Edward going in with the Justice Blade straight away. Rage play into the back line. They have to pull through. Holy Baptism does not get them out of that situation, but oh my goodness. Wise making sure. He finds it again. You look away for a second and blink, he's gone.
Oheb with the snipes. This guy, the Filipino sniper right now. But look at this man. This is Onyx literally on their doors. This is going to be Blacklist International. Keep on going in. And man, it is looking ferocious. It is looking like a disaster for Onyx.
Yep, it's not looking good at all. Sands has to use the perfect execution to get on out of there. But Boots, he's trying his very best. He can tank only so much damage, but his members need to stop getting hit by this Filipino sniper.
And it does not miss. The thing is, Blacklist International are really making it so that he is activated. They really make the way so that Oheb will be in great position. They have the Lapu-Lapu as well as the Matilda to just peel through the members of Onyx Esports, and Wise always makes sure that he is always near the vicinity of Oheb so that whenever Onyx Esports wants to initiate, he's there for the Daytona's Welcome so that he'll eventually stop the aggression from Onyx Esports. And not to mention Haji as the vision provider for Blacklist International. That Feathered Airstrike really zones out the members of Onyx Esports so much. This is big trouble for Onyx Esports as 12 minutes into this game, they're down by 10K.
I've brought this up before, but like when you see a 10K goal lead at this stage of the game, especially at the 12-minute mark, this is almost checkmate in a lot of situations for a lot of these great teams. I really want to see how Onyx Esports holds out here as Blacklist is going to be knocking on their door. Complete disrespect. They're walking right up into the base. They want to end this quick. Here it comes. We're already seeing the engagement. Oheb finds up with the perfect execution getting towards that back line. Daytona's Welcome not going to connect onto the right targets as Boots is managing to deny it. Edward is doing a great job. Rage Blades trying his best, finds the kill. A mega kill going over as Boots falls to the hands of Oheb. It's 2-0 so far, but the crystal is wide open and Oheb going to slowly chip away at the main base. Feathered Airstrike again. Keyboy can only do so much. CW in some trouble. Sands, he's trying to hold on. Thorn Rose cut through, doesn't get the combo. That's a third, and that is going to be it. Blacklist International move to the next round. GG, well played.
Oh my God, crisp, clean precision from Blacklist International. The Filipino champs will dethrone the MPL and MPLI champions. Oh my God, that was amazing, and what a match.
What a match indeed.
It is one hell of a game. But Blacklist have achieved their sweet, sweet retribution after their performance in MPLI. They've got the revenge.
The story still holds true. MPLI, unfortunately, the championship will not net them any further into the tournament as Blacklist International denies them of that. Edward was phenomenal with this last pick, Lapu-Lapu, and we talked about that pick. So much emotion